for inviting me to here, and it's my first visit in Korea. I didn't expect it so cold, but I got used to such weather when I was young. I grew up in Russia, so. But now, after being for 17 years in California, I lost immunity to the cold. So, but it's fine. So I'm going to talk about homological invariants of algebraic groups, and they were introduced by Serre in the 90s. And he visited UCLA in the year of 2001 and gave a course on this subject, and then a book appeared on homological invariants of algebraic groups. So, before giving the definition of an invariant, I would like to discuss in some details the ingredients of the definition. And I would like to start with the section on algebraic groups. Well, the algebraic group is, by definition, variety over some field F, algebraic variety, and a group. So it's an algebraic variety having a group structure. And I will only consider affine algebraic groups. So those given by some system of polynomial equations in the affine space. Well, what are the basic examples of algebraic groups? Every finite group, which is a variety, just union of finitely many points, has a structure of an algebraic group. Second, the affine space. Has the structure of the additive algebraic group. GM, the multiplicative group. It is just the affine line without the origin. And it's multiplicative group. Group. And the product of several copies of GM with itself, it is called the torus, split torus of dimension D. It's just a group of diagonal D by D matrices with non-zero entries at the diagonal. GLN, general linear group, or similarly, general linear group of a vector space are examples of algebraic groups. If you take a quadratic form, you can take the orthogonal group of the quadratic form. Orthogonal group. Transformations of the quadratic form which preserve the quadratic form. The transformation of the vector space preserving the quadratic form. 6, PGLN. The projective linear group. Well, abstractly it is just the factor group of GLN modulo the subgroup of scalar matrices, which is just the GM. But the factor group structure is not so obvious in the theory of algebraic groups, because we need to see that it's a variety. Well, of course, we can look at this as an open set in the projective space. But maybe a better way to think of it is the automorphism group of the algebra of matrices n by n over f. So every matrix, every automorphism of the algebra of matrices is inner, so it's given by an invertible matrix up to a scalar matrix. So in the last two examples, the algebraic groups, a group appears as the automorphism group of some object. So automorphism group of the matrix algebra, automorphism group of a quadratic form. And in fact, this is a very general situation. Very generally, many algebraic groups appear as the automorphism groups of some, well, algebraic object or algebraic structure. And I would like to explain what it means. In fact, this algebraic object or algebraic structure should be based again, I will explain what it means, on a vector space. So let's take a vector space V over our base field F, and suppose that the general linear group of V acts linearly on some other vector space, on a vector space W. Or equivalently, we are given a representation of GLV. To give such an action is the same as to give a group homomorphism from GLV to GLW representation. Okay, then we fix a vector, say W0, in the second vector space. This is our algebraic structure. And then look at the group G of all elements in the space G, in GL of V, such that G does not change the W0. Remember, the G acts on W, so it makes sense to write. So the stabilizer of W0. And stabilizer of W0. This is a subgroup, closed subgroup in GLV. And it can be thought of as the automorphism group of W0. We will extend this example soon, but let me give you a particular example. When A is, say, an algebra over F, you take for the vector space the algebra A, and the only structure of this algebra is the multiplication. So algebra is a vector space together with the binary multiplication. So what's the multiplication? Multiplication is a map from A tensor product with itself to A. Multiplication, or the product map in the algebra. So for the other vector space, you take the vector space of all homomorphisms from A times A to A, where leaves the multiplication. And that's what we take for W0. So what is the group G? The group G is a subgroup of GL of V of the algebra, of all linear transformations of the algebra, but those which preserve the W0, which preserves the multiplication. So in other words, G is exactly the automorphism group of A considered as an F-algebra. So that's how we think of the automorphism group of an algebraic structure as an algebraic group. And there are zillions of examples like this. As I said, number five is also of this shape and many others. Well, the next ingredient of the definition is the notion of a torsor. Next section, torsors. Torsors. Well, let us start with some abstract situation. You have an abstract group, G abstract group, not necessarily algebraic. And G acts on the left on a set X. What does it mean? It means that we are given a map G times X to X, the action map. A pair GX goes to, GX, the action map. And we can form another map from G cross X to X cross X. GX goes to GX, comma X. It is identity on the second component. And then you see immediately that this map is surjective if and only if the action is transitive. And this map is injective if and only if the stabilizers of the action are trivial stabilizers. So in other words, the action is, this map is bijective if and only if G acts on X simply transitively. Well, I didn't say very important thing that I assume that X is not empty, otherwise map is bijective, but simply transitive means that, well, its action is transitive with trivial stabilizers. In other words, a choice, the choice of a point gives you a bijection between G and X. G goes to GX. So X with simply transitive action is isomorphic to the group G, with G acting on itself by left translations. So there's only one set up to isomorphism on which G acts simply transitively. So that's the underlying idea of the notion of a torsor for an algebraic group. Now we have G, the algebraic group, over F, and X, the variety over F. And we assume that G acts on X. So we have an action map, the action morphism of varieties. And again, we assume that X is non-empty. And then we form the same map, G cross X to X cross X. GX goes to GXX. And we say that X is a G torsor over F if this map called phi is an isomorphism. Well, there's a small difference, but very important, with this definition and the abstract definition. The thing is that X may have no point at all over the ground field. So if variety X has a point over a field F, and this is the set of points of the variety X over F, if this is non-empty, we, in the same way, prove that X is isomorphic to G. With the action of G on itself by left translations. In this case, we say that X is a trivial torsor. Trivial G torsor. But if X of F is empty, and of course this never happens if F is algebraically closed, right? So in classical algebraic geometry, over C, this doesn't happen. All torsors are trivial. If X of F is non-empty, then of course X is not isomorphic to G. G has the identity point, X has no point at all. So it's non-trivial torsor. Well, just a particular example. Well, let's take for the group G given by the equation x squared plus y squared is equal to 1. You can think of it as a unit square with a complex multiplication by the formula given by the complex multiplication. So it's a group. And what is x? X also lives in A2 and is given by the equation x squared plus y squared is equal to A. A is some fixed element in the ground field F. Well, non-zero, F star, non-zero, call it XA, depending on A. And, well, those are complex numbers, if you want, of absolute value A. And the complex multiplication immediately shows that G acts on XA, and it acts simply transitively. So XA is a G torsor over the ground field F. When the equation x squared plus y squared equals A has a solution in the ground field, then it's trivial torsor. If it has no solution, like if A is negative number and the ground field is the field of reals, this is an example of a torsor without rational points, but non-trivial torsor for G. Well, many examples of torsors appear when we have the group G as the automorphism group of some object, as before. So now let's go to our situation when G is the automorphism group of some algebraic structure. Let me call A0. It's an algebraic structure. Well, it's given by some representation of the group GLV. It's based on the vector space V. In particular, we can do the construction of the base field extension. We would like to understand G torsors for that group G. First of all, suppose we are given another algebraic structure. And we say A is a twisted form of A0, if when you change the scalars from F to the algebraic, to separable closure, F sep over F is a separable closure of F. When we extend the scalars to the separable closure, the object becomes isomorphic to A0. But A itself may not be isomorphic to A0. So if A is a twisted form, then you can look at the morphisms between A and A0. Not just simply morphisms, but isomorphisms. Well, we will see that this gadget has the structure of an algebraic variety, X. Well, it may have no points over the ground field because there may be no isomorphisms between A and A0, simply because A is not isomorphic to A0. So X has no point over the ground field. But it does have points over separable closure because, well, the objects A and A0 are isomorphic over the algebraic closure. Well, we'll see that it's a variety. Moreover, G acts on X by composition. So G is an automorphism. You can compose any isomorphism between A and A0 with this automorphism. You get an action of G on X. And it acts simply transitively because any two isomorphisms differ by exactly one automorphism of A0. So G makes X a G torsor. So we got a map between isomorphism classes of G torsors for the G, the automorphism group of A0, and the set of isomorphism classes of twisted forms of A0. It takes a class of a torsor A, of an object O. Just the other way around, right? So for any twisted form A, we have the torsor X, the variety of isomorphisms between A and A0. But very often this map is a bijection. It is bijection exactly in the setting we considered before, when the algebraic structure A0 is based on a vector space. So let me explain why this is the bijection. So the isomorphism classes of G torsors are the same as the twisted forms of the object A0. Well, recall that we have an action of GL of V acts on the vector space W linearly. And we can, in fact, make a category. Category with objects just the set of W, objects are algebraic structures, and morphisms morphisms from, say, W1 to W2 in that category, exactly those elements in the group G, LV, such that G W1 is W2. So, for example, what is important that every morphism in that category is invertible. The G inverse is the map that morphism that takes W2 to W1, and this is the inverse. This such a category where every morphism is invertible is called a groupoid. So it's a groupoid. In the case when W1 and W2 the same element W0, we get exactly the automorphism group of W0, which is the stabilizer. So this is the group appeared before. The stabilizer of V0, it's automorphisms of W0. Okay. Now, we have.
Do you take the W to be the collection of all objects?
Sorry?
Do you take the W to be the collection of all objects?
W what?
The capital W is that the collection of all objects of the category.
W just the vector space.
Okay.
Any vector
space. And the collection of objects is all of W?
Yes, all of W. Okay. Yes, all of W.
The elements of so objects are basically vectors in W.
Yeah. Yes. Now, remember that we have W0, just some algebraic structure, which corresponds to our chosen algebraic structure A0. And what is X? X is the set of isomorphisms between A and A0. So if W, let's take W, a twisted form of W0. Then X is a variety of all isomorphisms between W and W0. So it is the collection of all G, variety of all G, such that GW is W0. And our correspondence takes W to that variety of all G, such that GW is equal to W0. And I want to explain that the map is bijections. I will construct the map back, actually. So now we start with a torsor. So let E be a G torsor over F. Well, what we do now, we take G L V times E, and then you factor out the action of G here. G X on E, because E is a torsor, and G X on G L V on the left and the right, and we will do the following action. G acts on, say, H comma E as follows: H G inverse G E. So this gadget is denoted GLV times E, and then with G factored. So we change the group from G to GLV, and it becomes a GLV torsor. That's a standard operation of the change of the base group. Well, yes, it is GL V-torsor. And now I use what is called Hilbert 90 theory. And there are many ways to state the Hilbert 90, and one of the ways is to say that every GLV torsor is trivial. This theorem will appear several times later, but now GLV torsors are trivial. So when you have this variety, GLV times over GE, since it's a trivial torsor, it has a point. It has a point. A point over F. Okay. Then we look at the product before factoring out the G action. This map, and then I take the preimage of this point. The preimage of this point, so if it is pi, that is pi inverse of the point, it is a G torsor because G acts on the fibers of this map. So this is the G torsor. Okay, what are the special properties of this torsor? You can project it to E. This variety can be projected to E, and so you have the composition of E prime to E. The morphism of torsors. It's a very strange property that every morphism of torsors is automatically an isomorphism. You can look at the substring situation when you have two simply transitive actions, one maps to the other, necessarily bijectively. So it's isomorphism. Any morphisms of torsors is an isomorphism. So E prime is just isomorphic to E. On the other hand, we can map E prime to GLV, projecting to GLV. So overall, E prime goes to GLV, and it's the G equivariant map. And we can map to W by sending G to, in fact, G inverse of W0. So if E, E prime is the same as E, E goes to some G, the G inverse of W. What if you take any G zero in the automorphism group of W zero? So G W zero is W zero. Then G zero E will go to G G zero G will go to G inverse G zero inverse W zero, but it's the same as G inverse of W zero. So you see this map is constant. The image of every two points is the same. So it's a constant map. So the image of this map to W is just one point, W. So finally we got this point W, and E, finally E, consists of all G in GL of V, such that G inverse W0 is W, which can be read as GW is W0. And we just got this torsor back, we started from. Remember, we started from a an arbitrary torsor, got got this twisted form W and returned back and got the same torsor which is defined by this formula. So we have constructed that map. So E, we started from, goes to this W small, which is obtained as the image of this composition. Well, it's a bit messy, but the main point here is the Hilbert 90 theorem. The Hilbert 90 allows to say that every G torsor comes from the twisted form. I want to give a few examples of this construction. The first example, remember PGLN is the automorphism group of the algebra of matrices. So, PGLN torsors are twisted forms of the matrix algebra. And what is a twisted form of matrix algebra? Those algebras which become matrix algebras over algebraic closure. Those are known as central simple algebras. Of degree, well, of dimension n squared, which means degree n. Degree is the square root of the dimension. So central simple algebras of degree n are exactly PGLN torsors. Second example, symmetric group, SN torsors. SN is symmetric group, is the automorphism group of the following algebra F cross F cross F n times. So you have this commutative algebra over F of dimension n, and the only automorphism of such algebra is just given by permuting components, and the total automorphism group of S is Sn. So the S torsors are twisted forms of such F to the n guys. And what is a twisted form of the algebra F cross F cross F? Well, those are known as algebras of degree n. Et al. F algebras of dimension n. Et al. Algebra, well, by definition, the algebra which becomes the product of several copies of the field when you extend the field to the algebra to separable closure, or another definition, it is a product of several separable extensions of the base field F. Every Et al. Algebra is isomorphic to L1, L2, Lk, where Li's over F are separable field extension, finite field extension, such that the total degree is n of all these extensions. In particular, just one field extension separable of degree n is an example of an Et al. Algebra. And this is a twisted form of the split algebra. Well, we will need a relative version of G torsor. So far we defined G torsors over the base field F, but now we would like to define the G torsors over an arbitrary base. So we still have an algebraic group G, over F. And also a morphism of varieties. I is a variety and X is a variety. A morphism of varieties also over F. We assume that G acts on E. We assume that G acts trivially on X, on the base. And we assume that the map F is G equivariant. In particular, the group G acts in the fibers of that map over any point of X. And we would like to make this action so that it all the fibers are G torsors. So it acts simply transitively in each fiber. So that F is nothing but a family of G torsors over points of X, just continuous family of G torsors, which we defined previously. To formalize this, you say simply that the map from G times I, the action map to I, when we add one more component, but we add it over X, we take the product of I with itself over X. G I goes to G I comma I, so this must be a bijection. And we also add an extra geometric condition, technical one, that F is faithfully flat, whatever that means. It's surjective and flat, faithfully flat. In that case, we say that F, the map F from I to X, is a G torsor. So it's a family of torsors indexed by points of the variety X. Well, I would like to give example, the same example, but put it in the relative situation. The algebraic group G is the same in A2, just the unit square, X square plus Y square is 1. For E, for I would take also a subvariety in I2, but open. Open given by X square plus Y square, not 0. And then I have the map from I to GM, to the multiplicative group, which takes a pair XY to X square plus Y square. Then G acts on I, G acts on the whole, I'll say, complex plane by multiplication, complex multiplication. You always make x squared plus y squared non-zero. And what is the fiber over a point? The fiber over a point, A, is a point in GM, non-zero value. The fiber over a point is exactly given by the equation x squared plus y squared is equal to A. That's exactly the torsor we consider it. And when we change the point inside GM, so take A non-zero always, you will get a family of torsors when A varies. So it's a family of torsors, and in fact it's a G-torsor. A G-torsor over GM. And the value of A in GM parameterizes the fibers. Well, we will need the following nice important property of torsors. We can pull back the torsors. So if I to X is a G torsor, and we have any morphism from some other variety x prime to x, then you can pull back. I prime is the fibered product of I and x prime over x, is also a G torsor. So the pullback of a G torsor is a G torsor. In particular, you can pull back a point in X. So you have that morphism from I to X, which is a G torsor. And suppose you have a field extension, K over F, field extension. And you have the spectrum of K, which is a point, just one point variety, mapping to X. Actually, to give such a morphism to X is the same as to give a point of X over K. But when you pull back the I, you get some E, and this is going to be a G torsor over K. Over K. The way we defined it originally, a torsor over a point. So we have a full family, you just pick one point in X and then take the pullback, the preimage of that point, it is a torsor over the field. The question, how many torsors over a field you can get? You would like to do the situation when you can get every torsor over any field from just one. It is sort of a generic object, and every other object, torsor in this sense, can be obtained by the pullback construction. Okay, we define such things. They are called versal torsor. A versal G torsor is a G torsor I to X such that the following two conditions hold. First, for every field extension K over F, and here we say K is infinite, not the extension, just the field is infinite, which of course is automatic if the field F itself is infinite. But that's a technical thing you can simply ignore. And every G torsor E over K, just the torsor over a field, there is a K point X of the variety X such that E is isomorphic to the pullback of I with respect to this point X. So that's the thing. So you have this point X. So every torsor over point can be obtained by the pullback construction from the versal torsor. And the second technical condition is that such points X in the first condition, which give you the isomorphism, are dense in X. That is useful if you want to replace X by an open set. You shrink X, you still have the pullback, the inverse image of this open set over X, a versal torsor. Well, so every torsor can be obtained from a versal torsor, but not in a unique way. Even more, there are many ways, so all points with that property are dense. So this torsor is not universal, because there is no uniqueness property. And why, that's why it's called versal. So once you have a versal torsor, we know all other torsors, all torsors at all torsors over fields. Well, it turns out that versal torsors exist for any algebraic group. So let me prove this theorem. And in fact, it is again a consequence of the Hilbert 90 theorem. So the Hilbert 90 plays a very important central role in everything, and many statements follow from it. The theorem. Every algebraic group admits versal torsors. Proof. All algebraic groups are linear, affine, so such groups are closed subgroups in GLN for some n. So we embed G as a subgroup in GLN. And let's consider the following morphism from G to the factor, from GLN to GLN mod G. GLN mod G exists as a variety. And one can see that it's a G torsor. Every fiber of this map is a G torsor over the point. And I claim that this is the versal torsor. Claim. So this is a versal torsor. Well, I will check the first property that every other torsor is the pullback of this versal torsor. Take any other torsor over any field extension, K over F field extension, and E over spec K is a G torsor. You want to make this one as a pullback of the versal one. You look at the product again, GLN mod E. A similar construction. And then you factor out the action of G here. You factor out the G in that variety. In fact, it's a G torsor also. But this gadget is a GLN torsor over the field. Over K, in fact. And therefore trivial. Again, by Hilbert 90. So it has a point. Well, spec K. And then you take the pullback of this guy with respect to that point. You'll get some E prime, which is a G torsor over the point. And again, E prime projects to E. E prime projects to E, and therefore it's isomorphic to E. So E prime is the same as E. And here we map to GLN by the projection and to GLN modulo G. And the whole picture gives you what you want. We have this torsor, we would like to prove it's versal. We have the point to the base of this torsor, and the pullback is our original E. So E is a pullback of the versal torsor. So this guy is versal. Well, the second condition is also easy to check. So versal torsors exist. Well, unfortunately, this construction, although quite simple, is not really very useful in the applications because the number n is very big in practice. There is another way to do versal torsors of much smaller dimension. Again, G is an algebraic group. Now, instead of embedding G to GLN, we will find what is called generically free representation. So let V, vector space V, be a generically free representation. What does it mean? Well, first of all, it's representation, so the group G acts on V linearly. And generically free means that the generic stabilizer is trivial. So there is an open set, non-empty open set, U, such that for every U in U, the stabilizer of this point U in G is trivial. In other words, the group G acts freely on this open set. Unfortunately, we cannot require the free action of G on the whole V because V contains zero vector and G acts trivially on the zero vector. So zero should be removed from this open set and maybe some other vectors. And such representations exist for any G, in fact. So once you have a generically free representation where the action of G is almost free, then you remove the bad part. It turns out that there exists open U, but maybe even smaller than that, open G equivariant such that there is a G torsor from U to some other variety, which should be thought of as U modulo G. So G acts certainly freely on U. It's not sufficient to have the structure of a variety on U mod G, but you can shrink U further to get a variety. So you have a torsor over some variety of some open set. And in fact, this is also a versal G torsor. Maybe last time I will go back to our example of the unit circle to see that the torsor we constructed is in fact versal torsor. G is a unit circle, x squared plus y squared is 1, and remember the torsor was the following: xy goes to x squared plus y squared, and U was the open set in the affine plane given by x squared plus y squared is not zero. So this is exactly this open set, non-zero. This is open in A2, and GM is just I mod G. And this is the vector space. It's a linear space, a fine space. So the conclusion is that this is the Wurzel torsor. This is a Wurzel torsor. What's the main property of Wurzel torsors? That any other torsor over a field is a pullback of that Wurzel torsor with respect to a point. And remember, if you have a point A in GM, the pullback is given by the equation x squared plus y squared is equal to A. Therefore, every torsor, every G torsor over field K is given by x squared plus y squared is equal to A for some non-zero A in K. So the example of a torsor over a field we started from was just in fact the general example. It's every torsor is of this form. This property follows from the fact that that torsor is a Wurzel torsor. Well, I would like to discuss the Wurzel torsor in more detail. The situation here is similar to the one in topology, but not really the same. In topology, you do construct the classifying space so that every G bundle, which is the same as G torsor, is given by a pullback from the classifying space. And the way in topology people construct the classifying space is the following. You first take a contractible space EG. G now is a topological group. The contractible space with free action of G. And then you said the classifying space is just EG modulo G. If you want to understand this algebraically, first of all, we need to understand what contractible means. In algebra, contractible spaces are affine spaces. But unfortunately, we cannot have a free action, linear action of an algebraic group on a affine space because zero is always a point on which the group G doesn't act freely. So what we do, we delete from the affine space some part, like here. You shrink V to some open set on which the group acts already nicely. So in algebra, we can construct only in approximations of BG. We construct approximations of the torsor EG to BG. This is the universal torsor in topology, but now we construct only approximations. Which ones? Exactly these guys. U to U mod G for U open in a vector space. In a vector space. Well, when you say approximation, that means that some approximations are better than the other approximations. How can we measure the approximations? We measure them by codimension of the difference. So we say this approximation is at level at least R if the codimension of the difference V minus U in V is big enough. So the bad points we remove are really very small variety of codimension at least R. And one can construct approximations of level as big as you want. Why we need to construct approximations of high level, we will see that homology groups of this approximation, if the approximation is big enough, a level of the approximation is big enough, do not depend on the choice of the approximation. That's how you can define, say, the cohomology groups or some other groups for the classifying space without actually defining the classifying space. Abusing notation, we will write U mod G as BG sometimes. But only mean that U mod G is an approximation of BG. And BG doesn't exist as an algebraic variety. You can actually show that. The actual classifying space exists in some other category. So if you want to do the real classifying spaces, you have to leave the category of algebraic varieties to modify it. Well, now one more small sections on Galois homology before we define the notion of homological invariant. Galois homology. Well, F is a field. And gamma is the absolute Galois group. It's a Galois group of the separable closure of F over F. It's a huge group in general, but it's a profinite group. M is a Galois module, is a gamma module. It's an abelian group with continuous action of gamma. We say simply that M is a Galois module over F. We usually assume that M is a torsion module, as a group. Torsion. And we also assume that torsion is prime to characteristic of the field if the characteristic is positive. In fact, you can implement also the part which is P primary for the characteristic P of the field, but it requires some extra work, and I simply reduce to the case when M is an abelian group, is torsion group, is torsion prime to the characteristic of F. So one can define the Galois groups, Galois homology groups. It's the notation Fm, but it is the homology group of the group gamma with values in M. It's defined by cocycles as usual. In particular, H0Fm is the group of gamma invariant elements in M. Gamma M is M for every gamma. Well, we will need some computations, simple ones. For example, H1 F Z mod N Z. It is the group with trivial action. So cocycles just simply the continuous homomorphisms from gamma to Z mod N Z. So it's a character of degree N of the Galois group gamma. Well, again, Hilbert 90 comes here. It's another incarnation of Hilbert 90. H1F F sep star is zero. Well, we also will be using roots of unity. Mu in F sep, group of all roots of unity. Well, actually, I said that M must be torsion, and of course, F star is not torsion, but the roots are form a torsion Galois module, and mu n are the roots of exponent n. Mu is the union of all mu n for all n. Now we have the exact sequence mu n, f sep star, f sep star 1. This map takes x to the n for every n such a sequence, gives us an exact sequence of Galois homology for f sep multiplication by n. Then h1 f mu n, then h1 f f sep star, h1 f f sep star again multiplication by n, h2 f mu n, h2 f f sep star multiplication by n, h2 f f sep star. Okay, again the Hilbert 90 is the triviality of these two guys. Now the first term, just Galois invariance in f sep star, it's f star. F star map raising to the nth power, we get h1 f mu n f star modulo f star n, and for every a in f star, the element that corresponds to that class will be denoted by a in parentheses. Then h2 f f sep star is what is called the Brouwer group of f. So this gadget h2 f mu n is the elements in the Brouwer group which are killed by n, the elements of exponent n in the Brouwer group of f. But when you take the union of all the roots, which is mu, you need to take the union of such subgroups, and the Brouwer group is a torsion group, so you'll get the Brouwer group again. So you can write the Brouwer group in two ways. Well, M was an abelian group, it's a module, so it is an abelian group. For groups that are not abelian, you cannot define Galois homology, but you can define them in degree 0 and 1. And more precisely, we will do homology with values in algebraic group. That's the first link between algebraic groups and homology. So let's take an algebraic group G defined over field F, and you look at the points of the group G over the separable closure, and then gamma acts on this group G, although this group is not abelian in general. So you can define H0, well, H0, yes, of, well, let me write HI, only for I, 0, and 1. FG, it's abbreviation for the following, HI Galois group gamma with values in G of F sep. When I is 0, then we get the Galois invariant elements in the points over the separable closure, and that is G of F, at F points of the group G. And you define H1, Fg, using Wanka cycles. Well, the usual way. And it turns out that there's a relation between that set, it's not a group anymore, it's just a set, with the set of isomorphism classes of G torsors. So it's a link between torsors and cohomology. If E is a G torsor over F, you look at the points of E over the separable closure, and you pick one, E is a point. Then you take any gamma in the Galois group, and you act by gamma on E. You get some point of the set again, and this set is a principal homogeneous space over the group G acting on this set. So there exists unique G gamma in the group of points of G over the separable closure such that this holds. And you get G gamma Wanka cycle. So it defines an element in H1 Fg. So we get a map from, say, isomorphism classes of G torsors over F and the set H1 Fg. And important property that this is an isomorphism by ejection. Now, both are sets, not groups. So that's the homological way to describe the G torsors over a point. Okay, and then a last topic on the ramification in homology today. Well, let K over F be a field extension, and V is a discrete valuation on K over F. Over F means it's trivial over F. So in particular, the discrete valuation is a homomorphism from the multiplicative group of the field K to Z. And it's the value of the discrete valuation, homomorphism. Well, for any N, it gives you a map, a module of the n's powers, Z mod n Z. The first group can be viewed as H1 K mu n. We computed this group. And the second group can be viewed as H0. Now write K bar. K bar is the residue field. A residue field. Z mod n Z. So we have a map actually given by the valuation, which lowers the degree by one and does something with the module. Well, you can express explicitly what happens with the module. In general, if M is the Galois module over F, remember it's always torsion. Assume that even N times M is zero for some integer N, then you can twist M. You can twist M by the integer I, which by definition means the tensor product of M with mu M tensor power I. You tensor with mu n, I times. And when you want, well, it's for I positive. When you want to untwist I positive, so you untwist I, it's the same as home from the same mu n I to M. So in particular, when we untwist one in mu n, you get z mod n z. So here is the group untwisted one in mu n. It turns out that in general, for every cohomology group I, k mu n, we have a map. It's called the residue map. Residue map to H, or not mu n, it's any map, any M, to H I minus 1, the degree lowers by 1, the field replaces by the residue field, and you untwist 1 in M. We have always such a residue map. And an element A in the cohomology group is called unramified with respect to the evaluation V if the residue map of, maybe I write delta V of A is zero. How can one get discrete valuations? From algebraic geometry, you have X, say, smooth variety over F. And you take a point of codimension 1, or equivalently irreducible divisor. I prefer to speak of points. X in X1, a point of codimension 1. Irreducible divisor. Then it is known that the local ring of the field of the variety in this point is exactly the valuation ring. It's dimension one, regular local ring. It's a valuation ring. And it sits in the function field of X. I assume that X is irreducible. F of X is a field of rational functions. In fact, it is the quotient field of that evaluation ring. So it has a valuation. So Vx is a corresponding valuation, discrete valuation of the field F of X. It's trivial over F. Now, we have as many valuations as points of codimension 1, or irreducible subvarieties of codimension 1. Now, if M is a Galois module over F, we can look at the homology of this module over function field of X, and you can look to the map of, to the direct sum over all points of codimension 1 of Hn minus 1, the residue field is the function field, residue field at the point, m of minus 1 is given by the residue maps at all the points of codimension 1. So you look at all points of all elements that are now unramified with respect to all the valuations of codimension 1 points. And the kernel of this map is denoted by A0 x h n m. We just write everything. X variety, n degree, m is a module. So it's a subgroup in the cohomology group of the function field unramified with respect to all codimension 1 points. In general, it is very hard to compute this group. What we know that cohomology of the field map to this group, Hn Fm map to that group, because there is a map to Hn F of x, and all the valuations are trivial on F, so we do get some contribution to that group. But in general, this map is neither injective nor surjective. But there is only one case when this map is an isomorphism. And that's the theorem I will finish with today. If X is either affine space or projective space, the map Hn Fm to H A0 X Hn of M is an isomorphism. So the constant elements coming from the field are exactly those which are unramified with respect to all points of codimension 1. This is a very special property of these two varieties. And again, for other varieties, it's extremely hard to compute this group. And you will see that this group will be very important for the cohomological invariance of algebraic groups. I will define tomorrow. Okay, thank you.